In case you haven't heard, the House of Representatives earlier this month just passed a bill that could lead to the criminalization of Christianity. And no, my friends, this is not hyperbole as much as we wish it were. This bill, the Anti-Semitism Act of 2023, authored by Representative Michael Lawler, a Republican from New York, is now in the Senate, but recently passed in the House. It seeks to address anti-Semitism and the discrimination of Jews. As we all know, anti-Semitism is alive and well in our culture today. In fact, in recent years, it has been on the rise globally, especially in the months following the Hamas attack in Israel on October 7, 2023. This bill is in direct response to increased violent attacks on college campuses, but it is also in direct response to the reports published by the Anti-Defamation League. According to their report, they documented 3,283 anti-Semitic incidences between October 7, 2023 and January 7, 2024, a staggering 360% jump from the same period a year earlier. In their report, the ADL also found in 2023, they received 8,873 incidences, another staggering 140% increase from 2022. They also found a minimum of 628 incidences were reported against Jewish institutions, including synagogues and community centers. They also found 505 incidences occurred on college campuses, and another 246 were reported in K-12 schools. They also found that about two-thirds of the reported incidences could be directly related to the Israel-Hamas war. But something even more profound that they found was that past trends were being reversed, that younger Americans were more likely to support anti-Semitism than older generations, which again is reversing past trends. And something even more profound on top of that, their report also found that across all generations, young and old, you pick the generation, they found there was an increased demand for a two-state solution, which again, brothers and sisters, as we all know, that's biblical. It's prophecy. But moving forward, this bill aims to crack down on anti-Semitism with the intended target being education sectors, such as public schools and universities where federal assistance is granted, or at least so it says. However, it also notes it can be used for, quote, other purposes. Just what those other purposes are were not specified. Some of the key highlights from this bill, and again, we will put these down in the description box below. It defines anti-Semitism with a working definition, which means that definition can be changed. And this working definition was adopted on May 26, 2016. By the International Holocaust Remembrance Alliance, a non-governmental body. It also seeks to expand Title VI of the Civil Rights Act of 1964, which prohibits discrimination based on race, color, or ethnicity in programs receiving federal assistance. However, Title VI does not cover discrimination based solely on religion, as the Act says. Quote, individuals who face discrimination based on actual or perceived shared ancestry or ethnic characteristics do not lose protection under such title for also being members of a group that share a common religion, end quote. Here's another quote. Quote, discrimination against Jews may give rise to a violation of such title when the discrimination is based on race, color, or national origin, which can include discrimination based on actual or perceived shared ancestry or ethnic characteristics, End quote. Now, the appropriate question we must be asking is, what is this working definition of antisemitism as outlined by the IHRA? There are several outlined examples of what would constitute antisemitism according to the IHRA, and we're just going to go over a few of those. But if you want the full list, we're going to link the website in the description box below, so you can check it out for yourself. So here are some of the examples of antisemitism that we pulled directly from the IHRA's website. Quote, using the symbols and images associated with classic antisemitism, examples being claims of Jews killing Jesus or blood libel, to categorize or characterize Israel or Israelis. End quote. Let me give you another one. Quote, accusing the Jews as a people or Israel as a state of inventing or exaggerating the Holocaust. End quote. Here's another one. Quote, making mendacious, dehumanizing, demonizing, or stereotypical allegations about Jews as such, or the power of Jews as a collective, such as, especially but not exclusively, the myth about a world Jewish conspiracy, or of Jews controlling the media, economy, government, or other societal institutions, end quote. And last one we're going to go through, quote, accusing Jews as a people of being responsible for real or imagined wrongdoing committed by a single Jewish person or group, or even for acts committed by non-Jews, end quote. Okay, so what does this mean? Here's our take. First, it is paramount to say that anti-Semitism is abhorrently wrong, no matter where you live, as is discrimination of any kind. Anti-Semitism is one of the worst evils out there, and those that know their history and have studied World War II understand that anti-Semitism preceded the totalitarian regime of Nazi Germany. So yes, anti-Semitism is a big deal. So no, we cannot express enough how evil anti-Semitism is. It is important that we, as Christians, love the Jewish people as we love our neighbors. We must remember Jesus was of Jewish descent through Mary. He is not only the King of all, but the King of the Jews. From agriculture to technology to science to medicine, the world has benefited from the contributions of the Jewish people since they became a nation again in 1948. And it is important that we remember that. It is important that we remember that we have benefited from the fruit of the Jewish people. And this act on its face seems like a good thing. Yes, it does. It does seem like a good thing. Everybody can rally around cracking down on anti-Semitism. But when you look at the bill and what it will do, it is an assault on Christianity, and therefore an attack on the First Amendment. And before we get too much into our concerns, we do have to say that when the enemy is working in the background, it is important that we realize this, family. The world is under the sway of the wicked one. The Bible clearly outlines this. So therefore, he will use pundits to disguise a particular bill, policy, or movement as a, quote, good thing. Or puts things under the guise of peace and safety. But we know what the Bible says, my friends. Satan and his minions come as angels of light, seeking to deceive and destroy. And when they say peace and safety, sudden destruction comes upon them. So right now, it is important that we be discerning, praying always for discernment, because we have entered into a time, into a period, where deception is everywhere. We can no longer trust our news. Not that we could before. But we cannot trust even the things that we see. Especially with the advent of AI. Okay, getting into our top concerns that are apparent when reading this bill. It is too broad with the language perceived or actual. Who decides what is perceived and what is actual? There are no clear guidelines or rules for such parameters. The lack of clear outlines makes a bill like this ripe for abuse. Its working definition of anti-Semitism is defined by an international ungoverned body and not elected officials of the United States of America. So again, it goes back to it could be ripe for abuse, and this international body could effectively change its definition on a whim. It also states that it would give the Department of Education the power to look into violations of, quote, anti-discrimination laws concerning education programs or activities and for, quote, other purposes, end quote. So essentially, it's going to expand the Department of Education's power on anti-discrimination. And again, what are those other purposes? None are outlined. Again, it's too broad, which means it could be ripe for abuse. And these are genuine concerns. We should be concerned, especially when it comes to our First Amendment rights. And also, it doesn't outline how this could affect 501c3 corporations or churches. So yes, the government could be getting even more involved with church organizations than what they already are. In addition, there are a few concerns that this act could classify certain sections, or worse, the entire New Testament, as hate speech, going by their working definition. And the truth of the matter is, we honestly don't know the unintended consequences of such an act will be if it goes through the Senate and is passed by the President of the United States of America. It outlines that Title VI does not cover religion. It says that. So therefore, there is a possibility it could infringe on freedom of speech and religion as the working definition outlined by the IHRA included examples of classic anti-Semitism, such as the teaching of Jews killing Jesus during his time. There's a huge gray area here. However, history does reveal that the Jews of the time did hand over Jesus to Pontius Pilate. Are we not to teach history, even if it is uncomfortable? The truth is, they rejected their Messiah. That's what happened. That's history. So their hands played a part in it. But the reality is, not only did Jesus go willingly to the cross, but the world crucified him, not just the Jews. Why? Because the Romans played their part in it too. As you and I know, there are sections of the Bible that outline that the Jews of Jesus' day were responsible for the crucifixion of Jesus. So therefore, according to this bill, are those sections now classified as hate speech? It would seem so. It would seem so. Now, we must say that we love the Jewish people. Even though they are blinded to the gospel, God is not finished with them yet. And it is important that we pray for the nation and people of Israel. And it is important to understand that they too need Jesus Christ, as we all do. It would seem this bill could act as the beginning stages of over-Christian persecution in America, and that is something everyone should be concerned about. As history shows, when Christians and the church start being attacked, the nation goes into chaos and turmoil. Case in point, the illness that happened a few years ago. And why does this happen? Why does the nation go into turmoil? Well, it's a form of judgment to try to get the nation to repent and turn to God. We must stand up for righteousness and acknowledge that anti-Semitism is wrong and evil, but not at the expense of religious freedom of speech and liberty. At this moment, we need more intercessors praying and fasting for our country against the persecution and judgment that is knocking at our doorstep, just as Daniel did when he saw the judgment that was coming upon the nation of Israel. My friends, persecution is arising here, and it is becoming more overt. And if one thinks that it can't happen here, think again, because just the other day, a pastor was arrested at the U.S. Capitol. Yes, here, the U.S. Capitol in Washington, D.C., just for preaching the gospel. So yes, my friends, it can happen here. And it is happening here. It is important, my friends, to not be complacent. We must continue pressing forward and fighting, because whether we like it or not, this country represents religious liberty and freedom. But my friends, be of good cheer, because on the plus side, whenever Christian persecution occurs, the gospel spreads. So, what can we do? Well, as we said before, we need intercessors praying and fasting. We need more people speaking up, speaking out, raising their concerns, writing their senators. Whether they listen or not, that doesn't matter. You plant the seed. You let God manifest it. You act on faith. And whether it happens or not, it doesn't matter. At least you can say you tried and the Lord's will be done. But He can't hear your prayers if you're not acting on faith. Well, that is it for now. Thank you so much for listening. If you enjoyed this content, give us a like, leave a comment, and consider subscribing and hit the notification bell so you may be notified when the next video comes out. Until next time, keep fighting, keep watching, and remember, our best days are yet ahead. Keep watch, keep your lamps lit, and remember, our best days are yet ahead.
May the grace of the Lord be with all God's people.
Amen.